The Slave Trade, the Story of the Atlantic Slave Trade, 1440 to 1870, by author Hugh Thomas. Chapter 33, Sharks are the Invariable Outriders of All Slave Ships. Sharks are the invariable outriders of all slave ships crossing the Atlantic, systematically trotting alongside to be handy in case a parcel is to be carried anywhere or a dead slave to be decently buried. Herman Melville of Moby Dick. Next day we saw an English man of war coming. When the Portuguese saw this, it put them to disquietness and confusion. Then they told us that there were people which will eat us if we suffered them to prize us, and they all enticed us. If they should ask, how long since we sailed, we must say it was more than a month. And they also gave us long oars and set us to pull. About 10 men were set on one oar, and we tried to pull as far as we were able. But it is of no avail. Next day, the English overtook us, and they took charge of the slaves. Joseph Wright, a slave in Kirlin, Africa, remembered. Sailing rapidly on a strong land breeze, the vessel was soon out of sight of the coast of Africa. Both enemies and friends of the ebony merchants, the phrase much used in France by the dealers in slaves, argued that conditions in the trade were worse during its illegal stage, since captains often packed many slaves into a smaller space than they would have in the past. The Duke of Wellington told the Congress of Verona in 1882, all attempts at prevention, imperfect as they may have been found to be, have tended to increase the aggregate of human suffering. The dread of detection suggests expedients or concealment productive of the most dreadful sufferings to the cargo. Several witnesses at a long inquiry into the trade by the House of Commons Committee in 1848 said the same. For example, J.B. Moore, chairman of the Brazilian Association of Liverpool, thought, year after year, I looked upon it that the evils connected with the slave trades have been aggravated by our squadron being on the coast of Africa to prevent it, by increasing the sufferings of the slaves. Jose Cliff, a North American Brazilian slave merchant, abandoned the trade because of the loss of life and increase of human sufferings, which he regarded as a direct consequence of British philanthropy. Yet, for the first 20 or 30 years after British and North American abolition in 1808, the size and character of slave ships probably remained the same as in the past. But in the mid-century, some ships were used, including steamships, which were capable of taking 1,000 slaves across the Atlantic. On such slave journeys, the suffering, through months intense, is of shorter duration. Captain Denman reflected in 1848, still, one does not have to accept as true every sentence of the terrible account of Drake's life as a slave captain and surgeon to realize that confusion was frequent and stowing of captives disgracefully done, so that there was often what he called a frightful battle among the slaves for room and air. The crossing was, just as much as it had always been, a pestilence which stalked the waters. Vile conditions were as ever also encountered in Africa. Slave captains often genuinely supposed that they were doing the slaves a real human service by carrying them off to Brazil or to Cuba, even if to slavery. Lord John Russell would tell the House of Commons in London in 1846 that a third of the captives intended as slaves for the Atlantic crossing died during the land journey on their way to the coast. But the time spent waiting in barracoons in Africa was probably longer in the 1800s than in the previous century, for, as we have seen, the captains tried to pick their cargoes in one sweep. Rather than spend weeks negotiating, speed was necessary to avoid. The interference of the British Navy, Lord Palmerston commented, The liability to interruption obliges these slave traders to make arrangements for rapid embarkation. Many children are said to have been carried on the illegal trade to Brazil because their size permitted the loading of a greater number. The existence of these depots, however, to some extent, made the control of the slave trade easier. Most sites were well known and they could be watched. The barracones were flimsy constructions, usually of bamboo, maintained by Africans. Suppose that there were 500 slaves waiting in a barracone. Since the repentant slave merchant, said the repentant slave merchant Cliff, a cruiser is in the neighborhood and the slave vessels cannot come in. It is very difficult to get on the coast of Africa sufficient food to support them. Thus, 2,000 slaves were believed to have been murdered in 1846 in a barracoon at Lagos because, on the other hand, the slavers Styx and Hydra, ships with Sardinian flags, did not dare to brave the British patrol, and because, on the other hand, the king of the place had run out of food. The inducement was simply that the feeding of so large a number of idle people was burdensome to him. It was sometimes suggested that if the British Navy, or anyone else, were to destroy all the barracoons, then the slave trade would have been fatally damaged. But the surgeon of the Navy, who had been quoted before, Dr. Thompson, in evidence to the Hutt Committee, said realistically, whether there are barracoons or no, the slaves will be forthcoming. Another picture of slaves waited in a barracoon was given by an American naval commodore, Henry Wise, who wrote from Cabinda in July 1859 how, in chain gangs, the unfortunate slaves are driven by the lash from the interiors to the barracoons on the beach, there in sea air, insufficient diet, and dread of their approaching fate produced the most fatal diseases, dysentery and fever. Often released from their sufferings, the neighboring soil grows rich and the decaying remains of so many of their fellow creatures, and the tracks are thick strewn with their bones. On a short march, he continued, of 6,000 slaves a few weeks back, intended for the Emma Lincoln of the United States, 125 expired on the road. The mortality on these rapid marches is seldom less than 20%. Such, sir, is the slave trade under the American flag. However unpleasant the barracones, slaves would no doubt have preferred to remain there than to go to the finer country talked about by the slave captains. An ex-slave, John Fraser, for example, described how in the 19th century, as in the 18th, the slaves often cried they still did not want to go. Would they have preferred to have stayed in the barracoons? Mr. Richard Monckton Milnes, the aesthetic member of the Parliament for Pontefract, asked him. Yes, said Fraser. All ex-slaves who were questioned on the matter also said they would have preferred to remain in Sierra Leone than to return to their own birthplace because, John Fraser insisted, Sierra Leone is a free country. Often in the 1840s, the presence of the naval patrols made it difficult to embark slaves at the barracoons, and so, as has been seen, the captives were forced to walk several miles, sometimes as many as 40 or more, along the coast to a secret rendezvous with a slave ship's canoes. As in the past, slaves were obtained in Africa by local dealers in diverse ways, and nobody agreed exactly how. Captain Matson, for example, thought that the practice of obtaining slaves by war and the destruction of villages had almost ceased, and that, on the contrary, one half of the slaves now supplied to the markets of Cuba and Brazil are obtained by purchases from their parents. On the other hand, the Reverend Henry Townsend of the Church Missionary Society, who lived for many years in Apacutua, a city of 50,000 people near Lagos, thought about 1850 that there was a key to understanding the origins of slaves in that territory. For example, a quarrel might arise and some fighters take place, and ultimately one of the towns was destroyed and the people carried into slavery, as many as they could take, and those who escaped joined those who had besieged them and made an attack upon the others. And so they went from town to town. An army of the worst class of society attacked in towns, each town in succession, until the whole country was in a state of disorder. The war first took place through revenge and was then carried on through the slave trade, giving them the means of carrying on that war because they found then the profit of selling slaves, which before they did not understand so well, they now understood. Several survivors of the trade of the 19th century gave evidence to the Committee of the House of Commons previously mentioned in 1848. One of these was William Henry Platt, then a prosperous merchant in Sierra Leone. He came originally from the region of Benin and was kidnapped when so small that he could hardly give an account of myself. I and a friend went into a field to set traps for rice birds, and then I was kidnapped. I think we took about 3 weeks to travel towards the sea when I was embarked in one of those vessels for Brazil. He waited for 3 nights on the coast and presumably, for this account, did not embrace that part of his life, was liberated by a British cruiser and taken to Sierra Leone. Platt had no desire to return to Benin, which language he scarcely spoke by the time he gave evidence. One valuable piece of evidence derived from a slave later known as Joseph Wright, who, in the 1820s, was loaded onto a ship at Lagos. Wright had been captured in the far interior and had been taken down to Lagos by canoe. Early in the morning, he wrote, we were brought to a white Portuguese for sale. After strict examination, the white man put me and some others aside. After that, they made a bargain. How much he would take for each of us. After they were all agreed, the white man sent us into the slave hold, where I was for about 2 months with a rope around my neck. All the young boys had ropes around their neck in a row, and all the men with chains in a long row for about 50 persons in a row, so that no one could escape without the other. At one time, the town took fire and about 50 slaves were consumed because the entry was crowded. Then we were all brought down close to the salt water to be put in canoes. We were all very sorrowful in heart because we were going to leave our land forever. And we had heard that the Portuguese were going to eat us when they got us to their country. They began to put us into canoes to bring us to the brig. One of the canoes drowned, and half the slaves died. They stowed all the men under the deck. The boys and women were left on the deck. Slaves were, as always, branded before their departure for the Americans. In this respect, there was no difference between what happened in the legal 18th century and the illegal 19th century. An iron with letters cut into it is put into fire on the beach, and a small pot containing palm oil is always in hand. The iron is heated and dipped into the palm oil and dabbed on the hip of men or just above the breast for women or wherever the slave dealer may choose to have his slaves marked. The palm oil is to prevent the flesh from adhering to the iron. Slaves bound for Brazil were still baptized before the crossings and all continued as a rule to be examined by a doctor. The doctor rubs them down to see if they are sound and picks out the best. Though many ships sailed without such officers, a respectable man would not go and a bad one would not be worth having. Sometimes, as occurred in the case of Mongol John, slaves were carefully inspected even before entering the barracks.